ってるんで。
いや、決まってる、
うん、なんかそこまで行ってみるか。
オンナモバガバデバスデバヤ。Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Where in Srimad Bhagavad Gita is chapter 10, the opulences of the absolute, text number 22. Vedanam samavedrosmi.
Vedanam samavedrosmi.
Devanam asmi vasava.
Devanam asmi vasava.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Vedanam samavedrosmi.
Vedanam samavedrosmi. Devanam asmi vasava.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Vedanam samavedrosmi.
Vedanam samavedrosmi.
Devanam asmi vasava.
Devanam asmi vasava. Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Vedanam samavedasmi.
Vedanam samavedasmi.
Devanam asmi vasava.
Devanam asmi vasava.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam. Vedanam samavedosmi.
Vedanam samavedosmi.
Devanam asmi vasavaha.
Devanam asmi vasavaha.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Indriyanam manaschasmi.
Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Bhutanam asmi
cetanam.
Vedanam samavedosmi.
Devanam asmi
vasavaha. Indriyanam manaschasmi. Bhutanam asmi cetanam.
Vedanam
of all the Vedas.
Samaveda.
The Samavi.
Asmi.
I am.
Devanam
of all the demigods.
Asmi.
I am.
Vasava,
the heavenly king,
Indriyanam,
of all the senses,
the mind,
mana,
the mind,
cha,
also,
asmi,
I am,
Bhutanam, of all living entities,
asmi,
I am,
Chetana.
The living force.
Translation of the Vedas, I am the Samaveda. Of the demigods, I am Indra, the king of heaven. Of the senses, I am the mind. And in living beings, I am the living force, consciousness. The difference between matter and spirit is that matter has no consciousness, like the living entity. Therefore, this consciousness is supreme and eternal. Consciousness cannot be produced by a combination of
Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Swasadi Gauravakaranda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Lord Krishna is describing how we can think of him through the different features of the material world. Arjuna wanted to know how to remember him. So the Lord is describing his different opulences, or vibhutis, as we are called in this chapter, is vibhuti yoga. So the opulences are being listed one after another. So here tonight, first of all, of the Vedas, I am the Sama Veda. So there are four Vedas. Originally there was one Veda, but later on the one Veda was divided into four, Rig, Sama, Yajur, and Atharva. So Krishna says of the Vedas, I am the Sama Veda. The Sama Veda, the Sama Veda is the hymns that are there in the Sama Veda. It's the most poetic, the most beautiful of all the Vedas. So Krishna says, Vedas, he is the Sama Veda. And then of the demigods, Krishna said, I am Indra, the king of heaven. In the higher planets, there are two planets, there is a Deva Loka, and above Bhuloka, and the king of the Devas, everywhere there has to be some leader. So the king of heaven is Indra. It's a position. Indra is not related to this one individual, but it's a position which someone earns on account of their piety, on account of their past activities. They're rewarded by being given a position. So the position of Indra, it entails a lot of responsibility. Of course, Indra is the god in charge of rain, and he's responsible to make sure that there's regular rainfall around the planet. Rain is important. Anna Bhavati Bhutani Pachanyat Anna Sambhava. Yajnam Bhagavati Pajanyo Yajnam Karma Samudra. Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that all living entities subsist on food grains, and grains are produced by rain. So rain is very important. Without rain, difficult to grow grains. And without grains, then people don't get proper food. They don't get proper nourishment. So Indra has that as one responsibility which he has, but he's also the king of heaven, and sometimes he's called on to deal with different demons. Just like there was the one demon, Vritasura, described in the sixth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, how this demon, Vritasura, was born to lead the demons against the demigods. And Indra was defeated, didn't know how he could possibly fight such a powerful demon. Vrita meant very big, spread everywhere. So he was very gigantic and ferocious. And all the demigods, when they saw him, they just ran away. Although the demigods were brave, when they saw Vritasura, it was so overwhelming, they just turned and ran. So Indra had to face the task of dealing with this demon. And Srimad Bhagavatam describes how actually initially Indra had gone to Lord Vishnu, and he asked Lord Vishnu to kill him. But Lord Vishnu refused. He said, no, you kill him yourself. But he told him how to do it. He gave him the secret. He said, you go to Dadichi and ask Dadichi to get the bones from his body. And he said, his Tadichi is very rich in austerities, so the bones in his body are very powerful. And if he gives you the bones from his body, you can make a pressure weapon. And with that weapon, you can kill this demon, Vipassura. So Indra did that. And he got the Tadichi to get the bones from his body. And he took the bones and then used them to make the Vajra, thunderbolt weapon. And with that weapon, he was able to cut off the arms of Vipassura. And after he cut off the arms, Vipassura swallowed Indra. Yes, he swallowed Indra. He had no arms to fight with, but he was so big, he just swallowed Indra, opened his mouth, swallowed him. But Indra was protected because he'd been chanting the Narayana Kavacha. So nothing could harm him. So even if he was inside the body of the demon, Vipassura, nothing could happen to him. And Indra, they said that after Vritasura swallowed Indra, Vritasura then sat down and entered into Samadhi. He took Samadhi. But when he was in Samadhi at that time, Indra cut his way out from the intestines of Vritasura. Because although Indra was swallowed, he still had his thunderbolt weapon. And he used his thunderbolt weapon to cut his way through the intestines of Vritasura come out. And then he cut off the head of Vritasura. But it took him 1 year to cut off the head of Vritasura. He was such a big demon. His skin was so powerful. It took 1 year to cut off the head. So that was one interesting pastime of Indra. Another interesting pastime was that Indra had given some different benedictions to different places, different people. And at some point he had to take it back, or he had to distribute some of his own sins to them, because he'd done something to help some people. So later on, Indra got in trouble and he had sinful reactions. But he distributed the sinful reactions to the people who he helped before. So he helped the trees, that the trees would be able to grow back even after they cut down. They could grow back. So that was the blessing Indra gave to the trees. So when he gave the trees his sinful reactions, then the trees would produce sap, poisonous sap, from its branches. Then he gave the benediction that water could mix with anything. You know, if you have water, you can mix it. If you have even the dal, you can put water in the dal. You can put water in the milk. You can put water, you can mix water with your potatoes, even, you know. There's many things you can do with water. It mixes everywhere. But because water took that benediction from Indra, water got the reaction that water would sometimes have bubbles in it, and foam, and it wouldn't be pure. And then women got a benediction from Indra, that even during pregnancy they could enjoy lusty desires. And so the result of that benediction was that they have to experience monthly menstruation. The periods which they have over them, that is the reactions for the benediction which they received from Indra. And then finally, the land also got a benediction. Land could be leveled everywhere. You could make it level. Even there's mountains, you could level it out. And so the result of that benediction was that the land, where you get deserts, the deserts should also be there.
Indra would give, you know, he would give benedictions, but when he got afflicted with sinful reactions because he killed Vritasura. So Vritasura was actually a Brahmin. So when he killed Vritasura, he had to suffer the reactions for killing of a Brahmin. So he divided the reactions among these four classes of people who he helped before. You have to be careful, you can't help from somebody in the future, you have to pay them back. So Indra is a very interesting person, the king of heaven. Sometimes he gets in trouble. He's not a pure devotee. He's not a pure devotee, but he's very powerful, very pious. To get the position of the king of heaven, you have to be very, you have to have done a lot of pious activities. So although he's not pure, he is to be respected. We have to respect him because he's doing important service on behalf of the Lord. And Lord Krishna always worries, how is everything in the heavenly planets? How are you doing? Are the demons giving you any trouble? Because if the demons are troubling the demigods, then the Lord has to come and help them. Just like he did when Bali Maharaj conquered heaven and took control of the heavenly planets. So then the Lord came as Vamanadeva, and as Lord Vamanadeva, he defeated Bali Maharaj and he took back the heavenly planets and gave it to all the demigods. So Indra does many, he's responsible for many of these different affairs. You can see, he's a man. He's doing a lot of service on behalf of the Lord. And we have to offer our respects to him. And then, Lord Krishna said, of the senses, I am the mind. So the mind is the sixth sense, superior to the knowledge acquiring senses or the working senses. Right? There are five knowledge acquiring senses, the eyes, the nose, the ear, the tongue, and the skin. And we have five working senses. Working senses, we have hands and legs. We have an evacuating organ and a reproductive organ, and then we have the speech also. So these are the working senses. But of all the senses, Krishna says, I am the mind. Higher than the senses is the mind. The mind is the king of the senses. It's the mind which directs. So we have to learn to use the senses in a proper way, and that the senses should be used. They should take direction from the mind, and at the same time the mind should be controlled by intelligence. Okay? So it's important that we use the mind properly and in the service of the Supreme Lord. Maharaj Ambarish is famous how he used his mind. The Vaimana,
Krishna
Parara Vinayor, Vachamsi Vaikuntha Gunana Vajane, Kalohariya Nandir Martinadishu, Shruti Chakrachukta, Satpatodaye. Right? This is the verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, describing the activity. Some of the activities of Maharaj Ambarish. In the very beginning, fixed his mind on the lotus feet of the Lord. So, mind is the king of all the senses. We have to use the mind properly. In the Bhagavad Gita, 6th chapter, Lord Krishna says, one can be elevated by the mind, and one can be degraded by the mind. The mind can be the friend, the mind can be the enemy. We have to learn how to use the mind in the service of Lord Krishna. So making friends with the mind. Sometimes we have to beat the mind. Often we have to neglect the mind. we have to understand the mind is not perfect. And thoughts come in the mind. Sometimes thoughts come from the past, and sometimes we're thinking about the future. We have to concentrate more on the present. Don't worry about the past, and don't think about the future. Concentrate on now. Be here now. Do what we have to do for the service of Lord Krishna. So using the mind carefully is important. And then Krishna says, of living beings, I am the living force, consciousness. So Srila Prabhupada's purport is focused in relation to this point. But Prabhupada makes the point that difference between spirit and matter is that spirit has consciousness. Matter has no consciousness. This table has no consciousness. Right? But every living entity has consciousness. The trees, the insects, the birds, the dogs, what to speak of human beings. But everyone has some level. Of course, as you go through lower species like a tree, the consciousness is very low, very restricted. And the consciousness in animals is also restricted. But in the human form of life, we have the highest consciousness. We're given the opportunity to have the highest consciousness, but we have to use that opportunity carefully. We don't want to waste that opportunity. Use the consciousness for understanding the Supreme Consciousness, the Supreme Being, and our eternal relationship with Him. So, the living force, consciousness within the body, it doesn't come about by chemicals. It's not created. It's not born and it doesn't die. The body takes birth and the body dies. But for the soul, it's eternal. Najayate mriyate vakadachin anjo. Najayate mriyate vakadachin. Najayate mriyate vakadachin. For the soul, there's never birth, nor death, nor having once been, as he ever ceased to be. He is unborn, eternal, ever existing, and primeval. He is not slain when the body is slain. Najayate mriyate vakajanchin, nayam bhutva avitava nabhuya, ajomadyam shastrato yam karano. Nahanyate anyamane shade. So Krishna describes like this. And Prabhupada is pointing out to us that consciousness is also not produced by chemicals. Consciousness is supreme and eternal. Consciousness cannot be produced by a combination of matter. So, when a living entity takes birth, it's not just by a combination of matter, but it's the Supreme Lord who places his spirit soul into the matter. Under the arrangement of the Supreme Lord, the living entities are taking birth. We are not responsible for the birth of a child. Someone may think, I'm the father of the child. But actually the real Father is the Supreme Lord. He places the spirit soul into the womb. So consciousness is eternal. We are also eternal. We are souls were not divine, and consciousness is also eternal. But the consciousness will vary according to the body. If you're in the body of a tree, the consciousness cannot manifest very well. The roots are stuck in the ground. You cannot show a lot of consciousness. But trees also have consciousness. Sometimes you can see the tree who shed their leaves. That's an expression of their consciousness. And sometimes the trees will blossom. They will produce fruits and flowers, expressing their pleasure or their satisfaction. But consciousness is restricted by the body. But when we are given human body, then we have the greatest opportunity, because the consciousness in the human body is complete. We have full consciousness. But we have to use that consciousness properly. If we simply engage in only eating and sleeping, then that is not human life. Human life is meant for thoughtfulness. Human life is meant for inquiry, for investigation, to understand who am I, why am I here, where am I going? And you have to inquire about these things. And it's important that important for us as human beings to search out the answers to these questions. We want to become self-realized. The human life is meant for religion. Animals have no religion. Trees have no religion. But the human being, if he is civilized, will have religion. Religion is important, and religion is to understand God, that there is a person, there is a supreme being, and he's a person. And we have a relationship with him, so we want to understand these things, very important for us. Okay, any questions?
Regarding the Indra, Indra, Parasit is a force. The demigod Indra, there's a force in the heaven. There's a chief in the heaven, heavenly planet. And how they take the force? They was waiting until the annihilation of the world. Then will be changed. Body will die.
How do you take the post? Well, yes.
We never hear about the any demigod is a passed away or anything. Never anything. They never give up the body.
What happens is even their piety is finished. When the pious activities are all used up, then they fall from heaven.
Oh.
They come down.
Yes. Oh. The demigods come down.
When all their piety is all used up, just like, you know, when your money is all spent, you know, then you come back and you have to go find a job, go to work or something.
So
piety is like that. It's like a bank balance, you know? If you have a lot of piety, done a lot of pious deeds, it's like having a lot of money in the bank. You can enjoy the results of your pious activities. But once you use it all up, then they go down. Then all the piety is all used up, it comes down to the earth of them. This is the karma kshetra. This is the field of work, the field of activity. Karma.
So they mean a lot of devatas are coming down, huh?
Oh, yeah. Brahma, Bhuvana, Loka, all the demigods. They go there, you go up there, they enjoy there for some time, then they come back. That's what happens.
They use up their time.
Very few go on to go up to higher planets.
I mean, all the demigods are always changing.
Yes?
Always changing.
Yes? Right. It's a position. Positions change, just like they told me they're going to have a new king this month, February, right? They're going to have changed the king every 5 years, right? So even the king of Malaysia changes every 5 years. But to speak of Indra, the king of heaven, he also changes.
So no point we have good love to them, because no point we have prayed to them, because they're always changing. Then they will be changing, they all cannot recognize us.
Well, you're praying to the person, you're not praying to the person, you're praying to the position, right?
Oh, pray the position, huh?
The person in that position. But there we have the respect. You know, it's got that position. Not something to deserve it to come to that position. You have to appreciate. You must have worked hard to them.
Maybe they will come like a very, very elevated soul like that. When they come in from the heaven after finish their retirement.
Yeah. Yeah. It depends on how they live, what they did there in heaven. You know? It depends how they relate. You know, some will be very elevated souls. Because in the heavenly planets, they will chant a lot of mantras, they do a lot of yajna, and they will offer a lot of prayers, you know. The demigods, they're offering the, what is it, the Purusha Shuddha. They're thinking all these things. So the demigods are very learned people, you know, they're learned. They're not stupid. They're very.
It means any the kings or the ruler must come in from the heaven, because they are born in the king family, royal family, and all the facilities already there.
Well, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, among men I am the monarch. So the king is a representative of God. They have a responsibility. They represent God. So yeah, of course they have to have a lot of piety to become a king. They have to have a lot, performed a lot of pious activities. They have very, very good karma.
The post. We just pray to the post. Yeah.
Huh?
We just respect the post.
Yeah, yes,
like a president and king, just post.
Mm-hmm.
Then can be changed.
And then we have to respect them.
Another Maharaj, the Samaveda, you can say the Bhagavadam and everything is under the Samaveda, because we are singing. Samaveda.
Uh-huh.
I say the among the Veda I'm a Samaveda.
Uh-huh.
The Veda Samaveda is considered our Bhagavadam, Chaitanya Charitamrita, our Bhagavad Gita is considered our Samaveda.
No.
Uh-huh. That's quite different, huh?
Bhagavad Gita,
Upanishads, all considered from, because everything in the metal of song.
No, Veda. So, Chandrini and Vishaya Vita, the Vedas are dealing with the three modes of nature. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Chandrini and Vishaya Vita, nice Chandrini and Bhagavad Gita. Rise above the moon, speak transcendental. So, the Vedas are mainly about how to live in this world, you know, how to be clear and joy, you can enjoy this life in this world. That's what religious is going to be speaking about. We live only touch briefly on transcendence. Not much. The flowery languages of the Vedas, you know, like describing how you can get material benefits, the flowers. They're beautiful, but not for very long. So the results of all the things from the Vedas is also temporary.
The main Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita is totally different from the... It's a summary of the Veda, huh?
Yeah.
Describe.
So, Bhagavad Gita is more than the Vedas. The Vedas is just dealing with the two modes, but the Bhagavad Gita is teaching something higher. Bhagavad Gita is transcendental knowledge.
Beyond the three modes of knowledge.
Yeah. People who just follow the Vedas, they just often want to go to heavenly planets. Their desire is for that heavenly planets, or they want for the best and they want moksha. Some people, they're doing the yajnas, they're doing the sacrifices and so on. Their goal is just to get the higher planets, to enjoy, to do pious activities, to enjoy. But the devotees, we want to get the supreme enjoyment. We don't want to go beyond the material world. We know there's no real happiness in the temporary pleasures of this world. This world is so temporary. But why should we try to enjoy here? We want to get out from this world. We want to go back to our real home. So Indra, he also wants to come take birth here. Committed offenses by trying to kill all the people in Vrindavan, all the cows.
But the reaction for the whatever the Indra did, but until now also we have the reaction is going on. The girls also take the reaction. The tree take the reaction, the water take the reaction, but the man is already for. The reaction by whatever is wrong they did by the Indra.
Yeah.
Just now Maharaj said, yes, the reaction of the thing, sinful thing, is shared by the three, four of them. Water,
yeah.
Plant,
yeah.
Girl,
the land. The land.
The land. But the curse still there.
Huh?
The curse still going on.
Curse is still going on. That's still going on.
The reaction is still there.
Well, because the benediction is still going on, right? Usually the benediction, all these things can happen. But they're still enjoying the benediction. So the curse is also there too, the mansions, because they're still enjoying the benefits which they gave. With the blessing comes also the curse. We have to be careful about taking blessings.